Hello guys, how are you doing today? I hope you're all fine, safe and healthy. I know I've been missing in action for the last couple of weeks, but here I am discussing yet another movie, The Other Boleyn Girl. Let me tell you a secret. History has always been one of my favorite subjects. So when I get to watch a film based on historical events, you best believe I don't miss that opportunity. Well, coming to the film itself, The Other Boleyn Girl is a 2008 romance drama based on the British author Philippa Gregory's 2001 novel bearing the same name. However, it is important to note that in no way does Gregory provide an accurate account of history in her book. In fact, it is said that much of the history in her account is not quite how the events had actually unfolded. Directed by Justin Chadwick, The Other Boleyn Girl opens with Catherine of Aragon, the 16th century Queen of England and wife of King Henry VIII, giving birth to a stillborn. As the king grows desperate in his desire for a male heir, the Boleyn family search for an opportunity to install their blood on the coveted throne. To this effect, Anne, the elder of the Boleyn sisters, is instructed by her family to impress the king. But that is not what her efforts amount to. Instead of Anne, it's her married sister Mary that manages to entice him. Soon enough, Mary is appointed by the king as one of the queen's ladies-in-waiting. And voila, she becomes pregnant with King Henry VIII's child and gives birth to a beautiful baby boy. The story should have ended here, right? After all, the king has got his male heir. Wrong. The child that Mary gave birth to was illegitimate after all, having born out of infidelity. What was to become of Mary and her child? And what fate awaited Anne, the other Boleyn girl? Was she to change the course of history? Well, you have to watch the film if you want to find out. The stellar cast of the film did indeed do justice to the storyline. The character of Anne Boleyn was portrayed by Natalie Portman, while her sister Mary was brought to life by our very own Black Widow, Scarlett Johansson. There was Eddie Redmayne, Alfie Allen, Eric Bana, and Benedict Cumberbatch in the other supporting roles. Honestly, I would have preferred more of Benny Batch on my screen. But that's a personal preference though. Huge Cumberbatch fan here. If I were to vote for the best performance, I would definitely sing high praises of Natalie Portman. She's such a great actress. Gosh, her face is so expressive. She can express emotions by just a twitch of her eyebrows and the trembling of her lips. She's shown particularly in the emotional scenes, mesmerizing the audience completely. Miss Johansson's performance was more subdued in keeping with the demand of the storyline. Her caliber lies in the fact that she can be an alpha and a beta at the same time. She can totally steal the spotlight if that is what is expected from her, as is in the case of Black Widow of the Marvel Universe. And at the same time, she can lurk in the shadows with such mediocrity that the audience will hardly notice her. I would give this film 3.8 stars out of 5. I wish the second half of the film was not so rushed. The first half of the film was well-paced, but the second half of the film was so rushed that along with losing clarity, it failed to leave as good an impression on the minds of the audience as the first half. I would highly urge you to watch this film, if not for anything but for the incredible performance of this stellar cast and the glimpse it gives us of the English life in the 1500s. It's currently streaming on Netflix. Do watch it, come back and tell me how you enjoyed the film. And we can have a chat in the comment section below. Do share, subscribe, ring the bell, and until next time, sayonara.